weeping and wailing. No more weeping and wailing. No more weeping and wailing. Going home to live with God. I will be done with the trouble of this world. Trouble of this world. Trouble of this world. Oh, soon I will be done with this trouble of this world. Going home to live with God. I want to see my Jesus. Yeah. I want to see my Jesus. Yeah. I want to see my going home to live with God. Soon I will be done with the trouble of this world. Trouble of this world. Trouble of this world. I will be done with the trouble of this world. Going home to live with God.
Amen.
All right. Thank you for the appreciation. An acknowledgement. I'm happy for my children. My children are always planning something for me. It's always a big surprise. Sometimes I wish they let me know what's going on. But anyway, I'm just thankful that I'm here. I'm thankful for God that's given me health and strength for me to live, to see my children to grow and do the best they can.
Yes.
And I'm very proud of my children, Angie, Tammy, and Anita.
Amen.
And I'm always proud of my grandchildren. So I'm just thankful for my community, I'm thankful for my church, and I'm just thankful for my health and strength. So I ask God to just continue to look down on us and give us the spiritual strength that we need. I ask in your presence. Thank you for everything. Amen.
We just about to do this last election. We have one of the greatest singers on this side of heaven here with us today. I tried to get her to sing by herself, but she just looked at me like I was crazy. And so I'm gonna help her out on this song, but if you would just welcome Sister Anita Burton. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Come on,
Anita. Come on. Sing, Nurse Anita.
I would have lost it all, but now I see you're there for me, and never would have made it, oh, never could have made it without you. I would have lost it all, but now I see you're there for me, and I can say I'm stronger. wiser. I'm better, so much better. When I look back over all you brought me through, I realize it was you I held on to, and I can say.
To stay here. Amen. Jesus, oh no. Amen. But for those that are visiting, I am not the senior pastor. I am a retired pastor, and I'm assisting the pastor here, Pastor Nelson Pierce. He is away this morning, and so that means you have to come back.
Amen.
To hear him.
That's right.
But next week, there's a joint service, and it's going to be at 11 a.m.
Amen.
And so, again, for those visiting, we share this facility with Norwood Presbyterian Church. They have service, and then we have service, and once a month, we have joint services. Next Sunday will be a joint service, so services will start at 11 a.m. They also was planning a Ash Wednesday service, but that is not going to happen on this Wednesday. Amen. So again, to our visitors, we invite you to come back. Pastor Nelson and myself, we are a tag team, and we have different, you know, we're kind of unique, and yet complement each other? Is that the right word? Okay, complement each other. He is a strong social justice, political activist type preacher, and I'm a doctrinal type person. And so we love each other and we mix it up. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And so we thank God. I won't be long this morning. The good is so good at our youth presentation was on Brother Ralph Floyd. And they didn't tell everything. So I would might as well just add one to that list. Our youth had, I believe it was the last weekend in July, had a youth type sleepover. And Brother Ralph, him and Brother Tony Joyner were two of the men that slept over. And he is, Brother Ralph, Tony came in first place. Brother Ralph came in second place. He's got to be the most loudest snoring person. I thought somebody was calling hogs. I woke him up about five times. And if Tony was here, he would tell you, them brothers, anyway, all right, it's sermon time. Anyway, and so I was watching NAACP Image Awards yesterday, and I believe it was Denzel, he made a statement. Let me just read it. He was talking about, you know, how these people had so much struggle to make it in the entertainment business, show business, and he was talking about sometimes you have to go through adversities to make progress. And so he says, the path of ease is the greatest threat to progress. Mm-hmm. And he said, if you fall down seven times, you get up eight. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know if anybody said, you know. So he was talking about that. And he said, you just have to remain faithful to your calling. And he says, with the audacity to hope. And so that sort of set the stage for our message this morning. So turn with me to Philippians chapter 1. This is Paul's letter to the church at Philippi. Philippians chapter 1. Tell Brother Roach, is that his name, that I miss him? Philippians chapter 1, I will begin reading at verse 12. Subject, caught between a rock and a hard place. Caught between a rock and a hard place. The phrase a rock in a hard place, that's been around almost since the age of time. It's a phrase that simply means that to be faced with the choice with two unsatisfactory options. Mm-hmm. Some call it being in a catch-22. Mm. Some call it being caught in a pickle. Some say it's like deciding the lesser of two evils. It's how many folks felt during the presidential election. They say, I don't like either one of them. I don't like crooked Hillary, and I don't like trifling Trump. It says, I'm caught between catch 22. It's like being forced to root for a team. I think it was last season, and it was between Notre Dame and Duke. I'm like, I don't know. I don't like either one of them. You know, I was then forced to choose between Duke and Notre Dame. You know, I said, it's like I don't like either one of those. It's like being caught in the pickle. But even in the more serious issue, sometimes men and even women too get up in age, and doctors may say you have cancer, but then all of a sudden they say, yeah, but you at that late age, and you're like, Reverend, is the Reverend, I don't know if I should just take my chances, or I should have the surgery, or just ride this thing out. Seem like I'm just caught, and I really don't know what to do. Even in our careers and jobs and financial choices, even in ministry, you reach a fork in the road, and it seems like either path is less to be desired. And you find yourself between a rock and a hard place. Well, Paul found himself between that proverbial rock and a hard place. And so we want to take just a few minutes, I'm almost done, just a few minutes to examine this passage that led up to him making that comment. And we want to answer the question, hopefully and prayerfully, what do you do when you're between a rock and a hard place? What do you do when you're in a catch-22? What do you do when it seems like you're caught in the pickle? Well, the book of Philippians is what we call the prison epistles. Why? Because Paul wrote this letter while he was in prison. This church at Philippi was founded by Paul on his second missionary journey. You remember Lydia, that lady that sold the color purple, dyes and fabric, that merchant from Thyatira. She was visiting the city of Philippi, and she was in her others having this sunrise prayer service down by the riverside. They were probably singing that old Negro spiritual, gonna lay down my burdens. Where? Down by the riverside. And the Bible says they were down by the riverside having a prayer service when Paul showed up. And it was right there that he established the church at Philippi. Paul eventually had to leave and go to other cities where he's going to open up other churches. And he found himself in jail. In jail for preaching Christ. Word got back to Philippi, and they were emotionally crushed. They began to have divisions in the church. Imagine that. A church with divisions. They began to have schisms. Imagine. How do you get there? And so they began to have issues in the church. And so Paul had to write this letter to them. And we'll go over chapters 2, 3, and 4 in the weeks to come, Lord willing. But right here in chapter 1, he wanted to deal with the fact and their anxiety that he was in prison. In chapter 1, he gives what I call the gospel in the key of F. Why? Because he talks about the fellowship of the gospel, the fatherance of the gospel, and then the faith in the gospel. Bear with me. He starts off by complimenting the church for their partnership and fellowship in sharing the gospel. Paul was grateful because the entire church, somebody say entire church.
Entire
church at Philippi was participating in the spread of the gospel and soliciting members. I mean, imagine that. It wasn't something that just the preachers and the deacons did, but every member.
Yeah.
We live in a time, I need to let you know, that we need all hands on deck.
Amen.
We need everyone spreading the gospel.
Yeah.
With so many things going on in our country and in Washington, D.C., in our communities, in our homes, in our pocketbooks, like never before, we need full participation. Doesn't matter if you 8 or 88. Colossians 4 and 5 says, conduct yourselves with wisdom toward outsiders, making the most of every opportunity to ultimately reach others in the spirit of love.
Yes.
I'm almost out of voice. It should be a natural desire when you reflect on the goodness of God.
Yes.
You remember when Jesus blessed Peter with that miraculous catch? Peter said, we've been fishing all night. And Jesus dropped your net on the other side, on the left side. You know, and Peter did that out of obedience. And the Bible says it was such a miracle, great thing of fish that the nets begin to break. And the first thing Peter did was start to share his fish with the other fishermen. Begin to share his fish with the very people he was in competition with. Why? Because whenever you receive anything and you know you didn't deserve it, you ought to want to share. Well, salvation is that way.
Come on.
I don't know about you. Ain't none of us deserve it. None of us deserve it. And so when we think about the goodness of God, that's what communion and the Lord's Supper is all about. When we reflect on the fact that God saved our tired behind and didn't really deserve that, seem like my mother would say, just seems to me. And I said, oh, a whipping is coming here. She would, just seems to me that you would want to share that with somebody else.
Amen.
And so Paul, he commended them for wanting to share the gospel. Paul was not only grateful for the participation and the fellowship in the gospel, Paul was grateful for the fatherance of the gospel.
Yes.
The believers at Philippi saw Paul's imprisonment as a setback to the gospel. Some begin to ask themselves, how can a man of God be so sincere and wind up in this kind of trouble? But we said it before. Sometimes bad things can happen to good people. Yes, sometimes we do fall on hard times because of hard heads and sins. Don't fool yourself or ignore that one. You remember when the Jews left Egypt, they found themselves stuck, and it wasn't until they dealt with the sin in the camp that they can move on.
That's right.
So yeah, sometimes it is our fault. Sometimes it is because we're not doing what we need to do. But sometimes bad things can just happen to good people. Yet folks, seems like when it happens, folks in society and even in the church will say, oh, he must not be living right. Let something happen, go wrong, and you know, with your relationship, on your job, and your pocketbook. Oh, she must not be living right. You know, that's what folks do. Sometimes folks, even in the church. I remember one time I had to confront someone, and they had to come back to me and just half apologize. I said, no. Don't apologize to me. You go back and tell those 10 people you talked to on the phone. And tell them you were wrong. And tell them to call the 10 people they call and say that you were wrong. You ain't got to come back to me. No. And so, needless to say, there were some folks in Philippi that had the good old corporate America rule of thumb. Kick a man when he's down. They began to spread rumors on Paul. So Paul enlightens them. He says, don't get all bent out of shape. He says, being in prison has actually led to the furtherance of the gospel. He said, many people have been saved, and those already saved have gone stronger and stimulated to greater boldness. I can imagine Paul, he was on house arrest for a while. He had these guards assigned to him, and I can imagine they had chained in him, and he's walking around, and they said, hey, what you in for? Paul says, preaching. Preaching what? The gospel. The gospel of what? Jesus. Who he? Paul says, well, I'm glad you asked. And Paul led him to Christ. That's right. Led him to Christ.
Yeah.
Second ship guards come in, You know, how is it? He said, well, he's changing this man. He said, oh, he must be some awful care criminal. He said, no, he's a scrawny looking fella. Barely see. Wow, what was he in for? Preaching. Preaching what? The gospel. The gospel of what? Jesus. Who he? He said, I'm glad you asked. And they led him to Christ. The guy goes home and he said, hon, you wouldn't believe it. I got all kind of overtime, you know. She said, I was just guarding just one prison. She said, oh, he must have been an awful fella. No, it's a scrawny little fella. But what was he here for? Preaching? Preaching what? The gospel? The gospel of what? Jesus? Who he? He said, I'm glad you asked. Led his wife to Christ. She goes to the beauty shop. She goes, oh, my booty got some overtime. I'm getting my nails in my hair. He was chained to a man all day. They said, oh, he must have been an awful man. No, he was a scrawny little fella. Could barely see him. Well, what was he here for? Preaching? Preaching what? The gospel? The gospel of what? Jesus Christ. Who's he? She said, I'm glad you asked. Paul said. Paul said. We don't know what to do. Paul said, he says, no, as a result of me being in prison, a whole lot of people have come to Christ.
Yes.
And those that already knew Christ, all they did was grew stronger and stronger. Paul says, as a result, this thing has just snowballed. He says, what happened to me was done on purpose by God. Yeah. But he says, what has happened to me, God used it for the glory of God.
Yes.
You remember in Genesis chapter 37, when Jacob's sons sold their younger brother Joseph into slavery. Some years later, they end up bowing down to him. And Joseph says, you meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. So both Paul and Joseph were persecuted. But it was because they remained faithful to God, the situation ended up benefiting the gospel.
Yes.
In the same manner, when we go through things, and I said when, but it didn't say if you go through things, you just keep living.
Oh,
you
really
go through something. Didn't say if you go through things, when you go through things, depending on how you handle the situation, we can bring glory to God.
Yeah.
I need to say that again. I says, depending on how you handle the situation. I say that because some folks go through hell, but it does not bother the gospel.
Come on.
Due to the way they handle the situation. All they do is go from one hailstorm to another, which is why we come together, so we can chew each other out in love, not chew each other, but help each other in love, that we can better learn how to handle situations.
Amen.
Because if we handle the situation right, God says, I'm going to use it for my glory. I need to give you a spoiler alert. This kind of wisdom in handling the storm comes from learning of God, and one of his primary ways is through his word.
Yes.
We can shout and run around the church and do a whole bunch of stuff, but unless we pick up
That's right.
You know, and some folks won't pick this up until this time next week. But that's another sermon. So often we don't want to pick up the scripture. We don't want to read. We'd rather read a horoscope. We'd rather read something on the Chinese fortune cookie than to read the word of God. So often we want to bypass the scriptures to learn of God as if it's some type of spiritual monopoly game where we can take a ride on the Reddit and pass go and collect $200. I like that game, but in that game, there's only two cards that gives you that thing out of the whole deck. It gives you that kind of grace. And yet we want to live our life as if the whole deck is stacked with these things. What am I saying is that as a nation, as a community of believers, we're ready to go through some interesting times over the next 4 years. There will be some battles that we will win, and there will be some things that we will seemingly lose. But depending on how we handle it, we should be able to look back on things and say, you know what? As a result, God did use me. And some other folks came to prison. I remember this man, his name was Taylor. He was sang the New Hope Choir, that shaped note choir, you know, them do re mi. Sang that. And the whole church was praying, and such a great guy. And he needed a heart transplant. And we had been in praying and fasting, and then we received word that he was going to receive a heart. And he had been at UC Hospital there for almost like 6 weeks. And the whole church was just so excited that, John Taylor's going to get his heart. And then he died on the operating table. And it just messed up the whole church. And then surprisingly, at his funeral comes about 15, 20 people we had never seen, mostly white. And it was all the people he had led to Christ. Led to Christ. Right there. In the hospital bed. Waiting on his heart. Right there. And so I think about this whenever I read this. Well, anyway, and so you may not be in physical prison, but you may be shackled and strapped financially. May not be on house arrest, but you may be handcuffed and held hostage by the bands of oppression on your job, in your housing, affordable health care, or even a lack of. So what do? No, you don't just stand there. Yes, you fight. And sometimes it is by any means necessary. But while you're fighting, don't lose focus on God.
Yes.
Take every opportunity to reach, rescue, and restore others, even your enemies.
Yes.
I tell you, I got through 35 years at GE because I learned to pray for my enemies. And when you do these things, don't even expect anything
That's
in
right.
return.
That's right.
However, I'm here to tell you that sometimes and oftentimes, God will make your enemies your footstool.
Yes,
I wasn't trying for that. I was just praying for that. But sometimes and oftentimes, God will make your obstacles the very bridge you need to walk over to get to the other side of the roof. I'm not telling you what somebody told me. I'm telling you what I know for myself. So Paul says, and as a result, many have come to know Christ. And those that are already saved have become stronger in Christ. Thus, when we remain faithful during storms, it encourages other folks. Yes, there will be some folks that's only there to stir a mess. But just stay faithful. And sooner or later, they will be exposed. Sooner or later, their motives will surface. I remember taking my daughter. They was young, and my one daughter liked to eat. And all of a sudden, she wasn't eating. I said, oh, she must be sick. And then sooner or later, you know, I saw the things on her skin and took her to the doctor. I said, she just caught the chicken pox. The doctor said, oh, no, she's been had the chicken pox. It's always been inside her. It's just now manifesting itself on her skin where you can see it. And I say that because God says, don't worry about your enemies. Sooner or later, it's going to surface. Sooner or later, it's going to manifest itself. You just continue to be faithful. You just do that, you know. And that's just how God does that. When God allows them to do evil, he's really saying, I'm just giving them enough rope to hang themselves. I think about Judas. He was one of the 12 apostles. But he also had the job. He carried the money. He was the treasurer. Jesus gave him that ministry. Jesus said, I just need to give him a little bit more rope. You know, and sooner or later, he hung himself. Right? Amen? And so that's what God does sometimes. It's only when we retaliate in an ungodly manner and act a fool that things don't go right. But if you remain faithful,
God will bless you with the wisdom in such a way that the enemy's motives would be manifest. Everybody would see it. And then he'd turn around and use it to bless you. The hard part. There is a hard part. The hard part is that the best way, I tell my daughters, the best way to, she said, Daddy, this lady's done this on the job, and I'm about ready to snatch. I said, no. She said, she's done this on the job, and he's done that. I said, the best way to expose an enemy is through righteous living.
Show love.
You just keep living right. But the problem is, we're not perfect either. And we have flaws, and we have struggles, and so we mess up too. And then all of a sudden, God said, well, now it's not going to work. Amen. And so as a result, doing the right thing is something easier said than done. Right. I know that. But again, that's why we come together. That's why we come together and share with one another and laugh with one another and cry with one another, that we may encourage one another. And then we can say, you know, sister, you really didn't handle that well. And we find the times that we can get on one another so we can help each other have that righteous living, because that's how the enemies are exposed. So finally, not only do we see the fellowship and the fatherance of the Gospels, I'm dealing in the key of F, and not only do we see the fellowship and the fatherance of the Gospel, finally, we see the faith. Church feared that Paul could lose his life due to this ministry. But Paul decided that he would live for Christ, even if it meant wrongfully losing his life. He said, in fact, dying would be even better than living, because in death I'll be with Christ. In other words, he said, if you're not ready to die, then you're not really ready to live.
Come on, watch out.
Paul considered it a privilege to suffer for Christ.
Yeah.
I said, I don't know if I'm quite there yet. But that's how Paul felt. Mm-hmm. And Paul says, I'm willing to suffer for Christ. And I actually thought about Pastor Nelson. You know, he has such a passion for social justice to the point that he would die for it. I'm not there yet, but I believe he would do that. If there was a demonstration and they says, they bringing on the National Guards, he get fired up. I'm ready to go jump in there. Am I right?
Amen.
Because he has a passion for that.
Amen.
And so Paul says, I'll die for this thing. And just so you know, I have a passion. There's some things I would die for too, but probably a different area of ministry. I'm just being all right. And so I understand that for most folks, it's not our nature to consider suffering a privilege. And so the message is not jumping at the opportunity to suffer, but Paul says, but when you suffer, if you remain faithful, God can use it to lift up Christ and draw others. Why? Well, suffering takes our eyes off of earthly comforts. It strengthens the faith of those who endure. It serves as an example to others who may follow us, and suffering builds character.
Come on.
And Paul says, I'm between a rock and a hard place.
Yes.
He says, if I remain faithful, either way, God will be glorified. Therefore, until he calls me home, I'm just going to lift him up. He says, when they scandalize my name, they only lift up his name, and for this I rejoice.
Yes.
When they kick me to the curb, if I just remain faithful, Christ will be exalted.
Yes.
When the wicked, even my enemies and foes, come upon me to eat up my flesh, Paul says, if I just remain faithful, they will stumble and fall.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
He said, I'm not going to fret not myself over evildoers, knowing that they soon and very soon will be cut down. He said, though an whole shall encamp around me, against me, my heart shall not fear. The war shall rise against me, and this will I be confident.
Yes.
He's the one thing that I desire of the Lord. David says that I may dwell in the temple of the Lord and behold the beauty of the Lord.
Yes.
And inquire in this temple. Paul says, if I make the most of every opportunity to love my neighbor, I can be assured that what folks mean for evil, God will use for good.
Yes.
If I remain faithful, I can be assured that all things will work together. So when you find yourself between a rock in a hard place, instead of asking God to get you out of a storm, Paul says we ought to spend more time in asking God, what is it you want me to get out of this storm?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Don't be so quick to say, get me out of this storm. He says, but if you're in a storm, he says, ask God, what is it you want me to get out of this storm? And then the sooner you can learn that, then the sooner you can get out of that storm. Amen. And so it would only cause people, when people see you handling that thing, he like, what is it about you that calls you to endure like that? I remember this guy, he was always bailing his son out of jail and doing this and doing that. And I said, you know what, if that was my child, I wouldn't do that. He said, if it was your child, I wouldn't do it either. But it ain't your child, it's my child. And I watched him go through all of that. And I learned. And then all it did is drew me closer to Jesus Christ,
watching
how he endured all that suffering and pain that his own child had called him. And so Paul says, when we go through these storms that we endure, you just make somebody else that much stronger. So Paul says, I'm going to preach Jesus. Is what are you in for? Preaching. Preaching what? The gospel. The gospel of what? Jesus Christ. Who he? Paul says, I'm glad you asked. He says, God, one day stepped into the very world that he created in the person of Jesus Christ. Walked around, gave sight to the blind, changed water into wine. The lame began to walk and the mute began to talk. And yet they crucified him. Jesus allowed himself to be crucified. And the Bible says, after 3 days, he got up. With all power in his hand. And the Bible says, if you believe that before and trust Jesus and Jesus alone for your salvation, that same power that got Jesus Christ up from the grave will come and live inside of me. And so we have been delivered from the penalty of sin and the power of sin. Only problem is we have not yet been delivered from the presence of sin. And that's why we come together. I'm working on it. Amen. We thank God for you. That is our message. We thank God for you. For those visiting, we normally take another 5 minutes. Because sometimes I get nervous, the preachers get nervous, and we forget something. No, you know, don't come out. And you might be sitting there thinking, you know what? I remember this happened to me. I wish he would have said this or said that. And so we take about 5 minutes just sort of meditate on it, think about it, and then turn to a neighbor, one or two, and just share something, you know. And so we give you about 5 minutes to do that, and then we will be back to continue in worship and giving. Amen?
Amen.
Won't you turn to your neighbor and share something with them? If nothing else, just let them know that you were glad to be here this morning.